I read a little bit of Job here. You can't read the whole thing, but Job is 42 verses long, and it's the book right before the book of Psalms. And real quick, the devil came before God somehow, and God said, "Have you considered my servant Job?" Because the devil was down looking at Job's life. And the devil said, "Yes, but would Job worship your name if you took away everything he has?" And God says, "Well, let's see." Now, I'm paraphrasing, obviously. He said, "Go down and take away everything Job has, but don't touch the man himself." Meaning he can't take his life. So the devil proceeded to take everything Job had, his servants, his children, livestock, everything, but not his wife. Now that's very interesting, because the devil let Job's wife live so she could come and curse Job. She said, "Why don't you just curse God and die?" That is how the devil uses women in men's lives. As a wife, as a Christian wife, you got to be very careful. The devil's not using you against your husband. Seriously. The devil used Eve in the Garden of Eden. The devil goes to the woman and tries to use the woman to destroy the Christian man. I told you there's two things in this world that will destroy a Christian believer faster than anything else. One is love of money, and number two is sex, sexual immorality. So, Job is on the ground, and his friends are sitting there trying to help him, and Job is covered with scabs from the bottom of his feet all the way to the top of his head, and he's using a rock to try and, you know, scrape his scabs just for relief. And his friends come and start accusing Job, "What have you done wrong? We know you must have done something wrong, or God would not have done this to you. You must be guilty of something, Job. And it must be huge, because God has allowed everything to be taken away from you." But they did not know. See, you're trying to understand the mind of God. This was a test between God and the devil. And after all of this was done, God lifted Job up, gave him twice as much as he had before, gave him perfect health, and then he gave Job two new daughters that were more beautiful. They were the two most beautiful daughters in that whole place. So God allowed Job to go through this tremendous torturing test. So if you look at Job in the middle of the test, Job is thinking, and his friends are thinking, his wife's thinking, "Job's finished. He's done, man. He's finished." Now, I pray that myself and none of you ever go through what Job went through. Now, was Job guilty? Well, we're all guilty of something. We're all guilty of some kind of sin. But what this is a testimony to is God owns you. God is the master and you are the servant. God is the owner. Jesus Christ owns you. And he can do anything he wants to you. And with you. And about you. Anything. That's what this is. If God chooses to use you, in such a way as a testimony to test everyone around you. That's God's right. He can do anything he wants. I heard a question once, why does God do what he does? The answer was, because he's God, he can do anything he wants. Most people are not close to Jesus today because they don't really understand Jesus is God. And they don't understand the holiness and the perfection of God. And Job is sitting here arguing with his friend, saying, I've done nothing wrong. Nothing. So at the end of the test, God speaks. And you know, after all this, God was there, the devil was there nearby watching, and then Job was there and his friends sitting on the ground. But Job was not complaining. He never cursed God. He never complained. You see, that was the test the devil gave. If you do this to Job, surely the man will curse you to your face. So God was challenged. I do not believe in today's society God allows the devil to challenge him anymore, in my opinion. I don't believe it. Because of his son, Jesus Christ, it is finished, it is final. On the cross, it is finished. That's what Jesus said, it is finished. I don't believe a lot of the things that happened in the Old Testament will happen ever again. Now, it doesn't mean that the laws are not still in place. I'm talking about the things like 40 years in a desert, the story of Job being swallowed by a fish, Jonah. No, God is not working through those ways anymore. He's working through his son, Jesus, only. He's only working through his son, Jesus Christ, and the testimony of salvation. So we're going to go through this because just a little bit here. I mean, it's several chapters that the Lord speaks in. See, I did a 1-year study on the holiness and perfection of God. I wanted God to reveal who he actually was to me. And it is vast. When the Bible says God is too high, too low, too wide, can't be measured, unmeasurable. His perfection, his holiness, can't be measured. It's when you get a sense of who God really is, then you know why he does things and what your job is on this earth. And sadly, most American Christians never find out who God really was. They know a little bit about Jesus. They die, they go to heaven. And everything gets stripped away from them, including most of what they thought was their spiritual gifts. They weren't. They get stripped away. You think you're doing Jesus a favor by going to church Sunday and helping someone bring some cookies. Well, that's nice, and everybody likes cookies, sure. But what does that have to do with salvation? You know, at one point after Jesus, the people kept coming to eat the free food. And the disciples had to get up and say, don't you have homes to go to and feed yourselves? They were just looking for the free food. Okay, let's get into a little bit. You got a kind of a sense of what's going on here. Now, God speaks to Job and his friends and reveals a small piece of who he is. And that's the only reason I'm doing this study. So you can see the profoundness when God speaks about himself. Whatever you think you are in this modern technology 2024 world, it's not even 1% of what God is right now. Chapter 38. I'm not sure if God speaks to him before that, but we'll just start right here. The Lord speaks, chapter 38. Then the Lord spoke to Job out of the storm, he said. So there's a storm, and God's speaking to Job out of a storm. Wow. Now, I'm doing this study to glorify God. Can you speak out of a storm? Can you make a storm? Can you make it stop raining? No. Then the Lord spoke to Job out of the storm. He said, Who is this that obscures my plans with words without knowledge? Oh, man. I should just close the book right there. It's so profound. Who is this that obscures my plans using words without knowledge? Is that how you talk? No, you don't. That's not how Job and his friends spoke either. In other words, the words you're saying have no basic knowledge to them. I, the Lord, and I have plans here to show the devil who the boss is. And I'm using you, Job, to do it. But you guys are down there speaking with phrases you have no idea what's even going on. I used to wait tables, manage restaurants. I had an old guy tell me once, right to my face, "Hey, Dave, if you don't know what you're talking about, how about just not talking?" It was a customer. I said, okay, that's good advice. The guy thought my attitude was stupid and he didn't want to listen to it. I mean, he was an old, like 70s rude guy, you know, and he was in his 70s, like 75. He was rude. But he made sense too. If you don't know what you're talking about, how about just keeping your mouth shut? My dad used to say that to his three sons when we were growing up. If you don't know what you're talking about, how about just not talk and keep your mouth closed? Who is this that obscures my plans with words without knowledge? I want you to compare your life that you think is so, you're so profound and full of wisdom, and you're the greatest thing since, you know, flapjacks. You know, the kind with butter and whipped cream and like some blueberries and some blueberry syrup. You think you're the greatest thing since those flapjacks. But we are not the greatest thing. God himself is the greatest thing. And when you start to understand that every single day, then you change the way you live. That's why for me personally, now that I understand who God is, it's easy for me to say, Lord, get on my knees and pray every day and say, Lord, what do you want me to do today? Because how would I know anything as good as what God knows? You should never say, Lord, hey, Lord, you know, I got that meeting today and I was wondering if you would go to the meeting with me and help me. Oh, hey, Lord, could you talk to my boss for me and get me a raise? Hey, Lord, I'm having trouble with my house payment this month. Could you make the payment for me? That's not how you should pray to a God who is holy and has unlimited abilities. The only logical solution when talking to God is say, be silent and sometimes wait for God to speak first. Like have a staring contest with him. Like you look at him, he's looking at you. You're just waiting for him to say something. And he might say, hey, it's my son. How are you? You say, I'm doing great. How are you, Lord? Well, I am doing fine, David. Thank you. What can I do for you today? And you say, what do you want me to do, Lord? You see, that's the only logical answer, question. What do you want me to do, Lord? What should I do for you? And mostly the Lord will say, just keep going, give you encouragement. Stop eating junk food. Call your mother and tell her you're sorry or something. Ask forgiveness. Read your Bible. Every once in a while, God will tell you some profound thing that he wants you to do. But if you have a preset of plans or ideas that you're on a certain path and you need help on that path and you can't get off that path. You see, you have to say to yourself, you have to be fully convinced, whatever my plans are for my own life is only 1% of what God could do with me. And I tell you, especially I'm talking to Christian believers here, especially in these last days. Boy, you humble yourself before the Lord and you don't know what he's going to use you for in these last days. Your life could get very exciting. Oh, yeah. He told Peter, go down to so-and-so man and start preaching to the Gentiles. The Lord showed up on the road to Damascus, and that's how he got Paul the Apostle. Who is this? Who is this that obscures my plans with words without knowledge? I'll try to read slow so you can think about it. But I also suggest you go look it up, Job 38. Brace yourself like a man. Wow. Have you ever had God say to you, brace yourself like a man? Doesn't sound like God wants us to be wimps, does it? Sounds like he wants us to be strong men in Christ. Brace yourself like a man. I will question you. You guys have been sitting here questioning me. I'm going to question you. And you shall answer me. Now remember, these words are coming out of a storm cloud. Where were you when I laid the earth's foundation? That's the ultimate question. Where were you when I laid... That's a scientist today. They're so stupid. They're like, oh, the earth was formed because some rocks collided into some other rocks. Uh-huh. Oh, humans came from tadpoles and then frogs and then monkeys and then apes and then cavemen and then humans. Uh-huh. The first question God asks, where were you when I, God, laid the earth's foundations? Were you there? Were you standing next to me? No, none of us were. Tell me if you understand. Well, right now, we all are just silence. Who marked off its dimensions? Surely you know. Who stretched a measuring line across it? Think about it. That shows specific proof that God specifically measured the earth to his perfection and everything in it to his perfection. Now, there's a God who has no limitations, right? That's what we find out there. A holy God, a perfect God, and no limitations. And for 6,000 years, the earth has been held in one place, spinning in space in one place. It hasn't moved. The earth is not billions of years old. The earth is about 6,000 years old. And we will have the rapture soon, the 7-year tribulation, and then the 1,000-year reign of Christ. I'm looking forward to that. That sounds amazing. Who stretched a measuring line across it? On what were its footings set? Or who laid its cornerstone? Do you know where the cornerstone of the earth is? I bet none of us know. While the morning stars sang together and all the angels shouted for joy. Wow, that's profound, my friends. There's God and Jesus, and he's making everything through Jesus, and he made the angels. And then he made all the stars and the galaxies, and now he's making the earth. And it says the angels and the stars are singing together and rejoicing at what they are seeing. Well, wait a minute now. I understand the angels. But you're telling me that the stars were singing? No, I'm not telling you that. God is. While the morning stars sang together and all the angels shouted for joy. Have you heard enough yet to stop asking God for stuff? Have you heard enough to be convinced? Lord, what is it you want me to have? Lord, give me the courage to accept what you want me to do. The stars were singing. Now, maybe not in a human voice like we can understand, but God understands them and the angels understood them. And the stars, you know, Jesus said, if the people did not cry out, the very rocks on the ground would start shouting and praising. Rocks would start shouting and praising. What is not possible? All things are possible with God. All things are possible with God. Who shut up the sea behind doors when it burst forth from the womb? The sea came out of a womb? W-O-M-B, like a child from its mother? When I made the clouds its garment. So when you're complaining about the rain and clouds, God calls the clouds a garment. He's blessing the land with a garment of rain, nourishing rain. And we complain, oh man, I got to go to lunch break. I'm complaining about the rain. You don't think like God. I don't think like God. Only God thinks like God. When I fixed limits for it, and set its doors and bars in place when I said, this far you may come and no further. Here is where your proud waves halt. Do you know that the oceans cannot overcome the earth like global warming tells us. I just proved it. Chapter 38, verse 10. When God made the waves, the oceans on the earth, he said, this is how far you will go and you cannot go any further. Wow. You ever look at the ocean? I live on the Oregon coast, so I look at the ocean and wonder, why doesn't all that water just come right over me and just go 100 more miles? I mean, I live by the Pacific Ocean, so it goes for thousands of miles. Why doesn't it just come over me and go 100 more miles? Because I know, I've known this for a long time. I read this book many, many, like decades ago. God told the ocean, you can only go this far and no further. Yeah, but global warming says that the icebergs are melting and the whole ocean is going to wipe out the earth. But God said, no, that's not true. God said, that will not happen because I told the ocean, I, God, told the ocean, I'm not going to allow you to go any further. You just have to decide which you want to believe in. Where your proud waves halt. Next time you look at the ocean, God calls those waves proud. Your proud waves. Not prideful, proud. Proud waves. Your proud waves come on the shore. You know, you can see the white caps like 10 out at a time on certain days. It's so beautiful. Remember, God calls those proud waves. Have you ever given orders to the morning or shown the dawn its place? God gave the morning orders. Wow. When you understand who God is, you rush to serve God. You leap for joy. You want to. Only a person with common sense would run as fast as they could towards Jesus. It is Jesus Christ who introduces us to this God, the Father. I'm telling you, when they ask Jesus stupid questions on earth, Jesus says, I only do what the Father has done. I only do what the Father speaks. Everything the Father does, I do. So we're sitting down here, you know, oh, my house payment, oh, my car payment, oh, my credit cards. Oh, my wife's mad at me. Oh, my children, they don't have enough video game cartridges. What are we gonna do? Have you ever given orders to the morning or shown the dawn its place? That it might take the earth by the edges and shake the wicked out of it. Well, you know how crime increases at night? Crime increases after midnight. Ask any policeman, they'll tell you that. And here, God just said, when the sun comes up the next day, he's shaking the wicked out of the earth. The crime goes down at sunrise. Do you realize, you know, science has it all backwards. God, there is a thing called the earth that he speaks to. There's things called the ocean that God has a relationship with. There's something called the dawn that we call sunrise, that God commands the dawn what to do surrounding the earth. Wow. Next time you see a foggy forest, God is doing something, see? The earth takes shape like clay under a seal. Like back then, it'd be like an ink stamp today on an envelope. Well, back then they used clay and they had to stamp it with an official seal, and then it would get hard on the back of the envelope. And if the seal was broken, the person delivering the message would be killed. So a little seal that we use for like court documents and stuff, God took his seal and created the earth. The earth takes shapes like the clay under a seal. Its features stand out like those of a garment. Now, I lived near Pikes Peak for 9 years in Colorado, 14,110 foot above sea level, and Colorado Springs is 6,500 above sea level. And this mountain, Pikes Peak, they call it America the Beautiful, America's Mountain. God calls that just part of his tiny little seal that he stamped on the earth and made that mountain. So you're sitting there, well, you know, I need to get some alcohol. What is your response to what you're hearing here? I need to get drunk? I need to get high? I need to look at pornography? So, but then you claim that you're a Christian? How are you going to stand in front of a God like this? Well, the only way is through Jesus Christ. You can never stand on your own, ever. It has to be through Jesus Christ. If you do not have the blood of Christ on you, you will spend eternity in hell, and God won't think twice about it. Because one day, God's going to create a new heaven and a new earth, and then a new heaven after the thousand-year reign comes down, and we will be with God and Jesus and the Holy Spirit and all the angels and all the believers, all those who have come before us for all eternity. And people say, well, what is God going to do for all eternity? Well, God's going to stop time, for one thing. There won't be any more time. No sun, no moon, no galaxies, no stars. All the light will come out of Jesus Christ and flow through us. You see, God didn't just create the Rocky Mountains. He has a seal that created the Rocky Mountains. Like, he stamped it in place. Now, I'm not saying he has a 3,000-mile-long seal. No. The Word of God was the seal that stamped it in place. Now, look, I haven't even read half of one chapter. The wicked are denied their light, and their upraised arm is broken. Have you journeyed to the springs of the sea? You know, underneath the sea in the earth. Now, it's really funny because it's been in the Bible. It's been in the Bible for, you know, before Jesus, that there are springs underneath the sea. But science just recently in the last 100 years discovered that there are springs of water coming up in the sea. Because they never read this book, obviously. There are springs. You can read the Old Testament, the great flood. God causes all the springs in the sea to open. And floods the earth. But science doesn't believe that. Well, I believe it. My wife believes it. My entire family believes it. Have you journeyed to the springs of the sea or walked in the recesses of the deep? So God is saying he has walked on the bottom of the ocean to look around at what he's created. Well, we know if we go to the bottom of the ocean, we're instantly killed or something. Lack of oxygen. He's asking Job and his friends, have you created the ocean? Have you told the ocean to stop? Have you walked on the bottom of the ocean? Do you know where the springs are in the ocean of fresh water? You say, well, that doesn't make sense. No, it makes perfect sense, because you know how when you have an aquarium in your house, and if you don't have that pump, on the outside, and a tube of fresh air going into your aquarium, the whole aquarium becomes, you know, like stagnant and dies within a week. And that's what these springs are. All the oceans, 2/3 of the earth covered with water, and God has the exact perfect amount of oxygen and spring water flowing from the bottom up. And science, they want to claim all of this happened because a rock hit another rock, and that became the earth and started spinning perfectly for millions of years. Well, the earth does spin perfectly. But according to science, the earth should have already spun out of control. But according to God, it spins in perfect place by his word. Have the gates of death been shown to you? Have you seen the gates of the deepest darkness? Wow. That sounds kind of scary. You know, God has said, you've heard of the storehouses of the Lord. If you follow me and do as I command and follow and keep my laws, I will open up my storehouses and give you such a blessing, you will not be able to contain them. Well, here, he's saying the same thing. Like the ocean has gates and lines. The deepest darkness has gates. Have you been shown the gates of death? See, all these things are like living things. How should you treat your wife or your husband? How should you treat your children or your mother and your father, your brothers and sisters? You should treat them like God's hand measured them out perfectly and made them. That's how you should treat them. When you are having a conversation with someone, it should never be arguing, hatred, none of that. It should be love and standing in awe together of what God has done. And when's the last time you heard, you know, of what God has done? But you don't think about that, see, because in America, as a Christian, we're so self-absorbed, we only think about what we're going to do today before we get home and get the TV going. Have the gates of death been shown to you? Have you seen the gates of the deepest darkness? Have you comprehended the vast expanse of the earth? Tell me if you know all of this. He's saying to them, go ahead, I'm waiting. You're not talking. Where's your answer? If you know any of these answers, speak up. Tell me. And they're just sitting there, no. This is the time they realize we should have never talked about things we have no idea what we're talking about. What is the way to the adobe of light? What is the way to the adobe of light? I don't even know what that means. Something about light, like where is the adobe? Where does the light live? What is the way to the house of the light, maybe? Like an Indian lives in an adobe, like a dwelling. What is the way to the dwelling of the light? I don't have an answer, neither do you. And I couldn't call anybody and get an answer. Nobody on earth. And where does the darkness reside? Can you take them from their places? Like, even if you knew where they were, can you go in and conquer them and take them and tie them up and take them away? Nope, can't do it. Main reason we can't do it is we don't even know where it is. Humility as a man following Jesus, living a life of meekness, M-E-E-K, meekness. Standing in awe of, like, if you see elk, stand in awe. Take half an hour to look at them. Stand in awe of all these trees and how they go straight up and down. Even though they're all on hilly cliffs, they still all go towards the light. Stand in awe when a blue jay or a red cardinal comes in your yard. That's when you will begin to know who God is. Surely you know, for you were already born. You have lived so many years. I don't know. I think God's being a little sarcastic there. He's saying, surely you have lived long enough to know these things, which is not true. Job is probably 50 years old or something. I don't know. I'm 62 years old, and I hear people my age go, oh, woe to me, woe to me, woe to me, brothers and sisters. I'm an old person now, and my life's over. Oh, I hear it all the time, even from relatives. I'm an old man now. I just don't know how I'm ever... That's because you're relying on yourself and what this world tells you. You're not relying on the one who measured the earth with a ruler. Have you entered the storehouses of the snow? Oh, I love that. Every time it snows, according to God, wherever it snows on the earth, the snow comes out of one of God's storehouses. If you're not standing in awe right now, I don't know what'll kick you going. If you don't think this stuff is a million times better than the Super Bowl, you know, the National Football League, if you don't think the things God has done is way better than TV, I mean, how can you read this and understand it and not take the TV off your wall and get rid of it immediately? Every time it snows, God opened up a storehouse and some of his snow came out and went directly, exactly where he wanted it to and exactly how much. God's snow is in a storehouse. And God has a relationship with his snow that is profound. But we're worried about electric cars. Have you entered the storehouses of the snow or seen the storehouses of the hail? Which I reserve for times of trouble, for days of war and battle. Have you ever watched on YouTube now how the hail in the world is increasing? And they just had a hailstorm. I thought it was Minnesota. Baseball size hail. Now, I know it hasn't hailed like that when I was a young kid. This has all been happening now. Now, look. We are hearing of wars and rumors of wars, and our earth now is in a time of trouble. Now, what does God say? I reserve the hail in storehouses for times of trouble, for days of war and battle. So when you see, you know, golf ball size hail hitting the earth, God says, I reserve that for days of trouble. If that isn't a sign to you, God's saying that should be a sign to you. I mean, what happens when you see lightning and thunder and golf ball size hail? People start running for their lives and screaming, and all their cars get smashed. Nobody calls that a blessing, and neither does God. He says, I reserve that for days of trouble, for days of war and battle. What is the way to the place where the lightning is dispersed? Wow. So there's like a storehouse where lightning gets dispersed. Now, if you look at NASA, what is it, like 100,000 lightning strikes a day on the earth? And God is dispersing the lightning every single day. You say, well, how do you know God is still doing that? Well, it's profound either way. If God is doing it minute by minute because he wants to, that's profound. But if God just spoke at the beginning of his creation and all this has been continuing for 6,000 years because he spoke 6,000 years ago, that is even more profound. When's the last time you could say something and it will continue going? First, talk about perpetual motion. God has the ultimate perpetual motion with his word. When God says a word, it keeps, like, make the earth. It just keeps going perfectly until he tells it to stop. And by the way, we are going to see the day God stops this earth. And a new heaven and new earth, we're going to see all that. We're going to get to see what the angels saw at creation, because the creation will take place like one or two more times, and we will be witnesses to it in our perfect bodies in heaven with Christ, because we were believers in Christ. What is the way to the place where the lightning is dispersed? Or the place where the east winds are scattered over the earth? Well, I think I got the answer to one so far. I think the east winds come from the east. That's the best I can come up with. What is the place where the east winds are scattered over the earth? And I say, to the east? The place is in the east? That's the best I can come up with as a man. I don't have the answers to any of these questions. Can you imagine if these were the questions on the college SAT? Everybody would get zero. And do you think this is God's best? No, these are just questions he's asking us. Do you think this is the best God is capable of? No. Not even close. And what has the devil done except kill, steal, and destroy? What has God done? Create, give life. And the devil comes to kill it all, destroy it. He's a liar. You can see the difference between God and the devil here. And I mention that because the devil is having this bet with God here that Job's going to curse him to his face. Have you ever got angry at God? I can honestly say I've never once got angry at God. I'm not trying to challenge anything here. I'm just saying I don't have that attitude. I get angry at myself or my brother or my wife or my son or my parents. I don't get angry at God. I've always known that he is separate entity. I've always known that God is never, ever the problem. God is always the solution. I am the problem. Other people around me are the problem. We get angry with each other. I've had many people get angry with me, and probably rightfully so, but I've never gotten angry with God. So when you get angry with God, you're on the wrong side of the fence, so to speak. You're thinking backwards here. Because it's not God that has given you any of your problems. And every time you try to tell God what to do, you're on the wrong side of the fence also. Who cuts the channel for the torrents of rain? Who cuts the channel? You ever wonder why we had these torrential rains in California for 3 years straight? Well, God is trying to talk to us. He's saying, wake up, wake up, wake up. Follow my son, Jesus Christ. Wake up before it's too late. Follow my son, Christ. Wake up before it's too late. And you are cast into hell for all eternity. Who cuts the channel for the torrents of rain and a path for the thunderstorms? You know, it's funny. God just said that he doesn't just send out the thunderstorms randomly. He cuts a path for them before he sends them out. That's incredible. You don't think God's not involved in your life? And a path for the thunderstorms to water a land where no one lives, an uninhabited desert, to satisfy a desolate wasteland and make it sprout with grass. You know, like down in the national park, I can't think of the name now. Palm Springs, the one there, the desert park, the one that gets real super hot. I can't think of the name at the moment. They have flowers that come up only every 10 years. And this is proof right here. That's when God sends the water to those desolate places. Does the rain have a father? Who fathers the drops of dew? From whom, from whose womb, W-O-M-B, comes the ice? Who gives birth to the frost from the heavens? When the waters become hard as stone, when the surface of the deep is frozen. So, this is proof. Don't ever worry about global warming again. God is in control of every single thing. And if we start to experience global warming, it's because God is forcing us to have it. God is in charge of what is global warming. It's the weather, the temperature, the ice, the snow, the oceans, everything. Do you think God loses his power because we have some plastic in our oceans? So God's like, oh, they got plastic in there. They screwed up all my plans for all eternity. Obviously not. God loses nothing if you throw a candy wrapper on the ground. No, that just means you're a litter bug and probably should pick it up and stop being a jerk. But it doesn't mean if you throw a plastic bag on the ground that global warming is going to start and kill all of us. You see the profoundness of God here. You see how God is in complete control and in complete charge of everything. whether you believe it or not. Can you bind the chains of the pleistels? P-L-E-L, P-L-E-I, pleidels, A-D-E-S. Not only can I not bind them, I cannot even pronounce it. Can you loosen Orion's belt? Now, we know Orion's belt is some profile, like it's like a Milky Way. God says, do you have the power to loosen that Milky Way in the universe that's, you know, like 2 billion miles across? Every time God asks you if you could do something, what he's saying is, only God himself can do these things and has the power to do these things. You know, the verse comes to mind. Jesus says, do not fear those who can kill your flesh. Fear him, God, who after you die can cast your soul, your spirit into hell. If someone destroyed your flesh and you died and you're a believer, you'd be with Jesus looking at all these things God is doing all the time. Wow. You say, well, I'm going to miss my loved ones. No, I don't. You won't. They will miss you. Maybe they'll miss your paycheck. But they won't. But you won't miss them. You'll be staring at this perfect God in heaven doing all these things. You're not going to be going, I sure hope my daughter does the dishes tonight. You're not going to be in heaven wondering if your wife's getting the laundry done or whatever. You're going to be staring at God doing all these amazingly profound things. Now, I'm glad I decided to do this. We'll finish up 38 here and then stop. It goes 39, then 40, 41, and then 42, Job replies. And we'll go through that at the end. Can you bring forth the consolations in their seasons? That's another thing. They say the Big Bang Theory. You really believe a Big Bang Theory? A rock hit another rock or an explosion or a sun exploded and all the stars move perfectly in a round circle for millions of years without ever going out of place? The Word of God, the hand of God and the perfection and the holiness of God is doing all of this. That's what makes it so interesting and awesome. And that same God wants to have a relationship with you, a sinner. He wants her, and he made a way. Jesus Christ, his only begotten Son on the cross. And then you can have a relationship with God for all eternity. And who knows? We don't know what God's going to do after the 1,000-year reign. Nobody knows what he has planned. Even Jesus said, the things I have, if you knew the things I have planned for my children in the future. I mean, even Jesus is like, I have so many awesome things planned in the future. You couldn't even understand it right now if I told you. Or lead out the bear with its cubs. So when you see a bear, a mama bear with its cubs, God's leading them out. He just claimed he's leading them out. When you go to Yellowstone National Park and see all that wildlife, people stand in awe because God made it. Do you know the laws of the heavens? Can you set up God's dominion over the earth? Wow. Can you raise your voice to the clouds or cover yourself with a flood of water? Do you send the lightning bolts on their way? Do they report to you? God just said the lightning bolts report back to him. They report to him. Now, my current earthly brain cannot comprehend or understand that. Why? I'll ask you a question. Why give 5 more minutes of your precious life to anything on this earth? You should walk the rest of your days giving every minute you have to Jesus Christ, just like God asked you to. And you will be finding all these amazing things out, you see. You will be living on another level that most people never even imagine. When people are out there trying to solve all their problems, you won't have any problems. You'll be walking beside Jesus doing what he tells you. So if Job is thinking, why have all these scabs covered my whole body? God is thinking, don't worry, Job. I can take them all away in the blink of an eye, just like my son Jesus walked up to the lepers, touched their skin, and they were all instantly healed. You know, I pray this never happens to me or any one of you, but if God said to you, I'm going to let you sit on the ground for a week in miserable pain, but on the 8th day, I will give you twice of everything you've ever had, make you twice as wealthy, twice as good looking, beautiful daughters, twice as much power and everything, and respect everything. Would you sit there for 7 days to gain double everything you have ever had? The point I'm making is, see, Job doesn't know, he doesn't know yet that God's going to touch him and boom, give him the rest of his life in complete leisure, luxury, wealth, beautiful daughters, marrying, you know, 2 powerful men later on. Oh, yeah. Because God used Job as an example to prove to the devil that Job never cursed God. And by the way, he's using this story to teach us about himself. And how no matter what's happening to us, God is in charge of it. You think, oh, I looked at pornography, so I'm in charge of that. No, God's still in charge. He doesn't want you to look at it. But the fact that you did look at it doesn't mean you took God's control out of your life. He's still controlling every move you're going to make. You say, well, why didn't he stop me from looking at pornography? Because God reads your heart, and your heart says, I want to look at filthy pornography. So God lets you destroy yourself and wear yourself out. And then you call upon the Lord and you say, I'll never look at pornography again. And then God reinstates you even better than you were before. God's not having you look at pornography, but he's in full control of every single thing on this planet. And one of those things is you. God is even in charge of death and life and light and darkness. The sun rises and the sun sets. The lightning bolts answer to him. All the galaxies shout and sing songs of joy with the angels. Who gives the ibis wisdom? I-B-I-S. Says a little note down here. It says it's uncertain what the Hebrew meaning is, the ibis, I-B-I-S. Who gives the ibis wisdom? Well, I could say, who gives you wisdom? Wisdom can only come from one place. One of the storehouses of God. And if he doesn't open up that storehouse and measure you out some wisdom, you're never going to receive it. So how do you get God to open up a storehouse and give you something? Ha, 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 yeah. You guessed it. You got to stop begging God for stupid earthly stuff like a house payment and a car payment. You got to start asking God gently, what do you want me to do, Lord? That's why Jesus was so free. No payments, no debt, no nothing. He knew everything about God. He walked around in peacefulness. As a man, he enjoyed eating his food, his healthy foods. Oh, yeah. He didn't wait for spring break and then go on a 10-day vacation in circles and spend $5,000 on a credit card just to go look at something, you know, 100 miles down the road. That's not living. Everything is contrary on this earth today. Everything is contrary in these last days to what God actually intended, as you can see. But some of us don't live like everybody else on the earth. We don't participate in the things that are going on. We keep our eyes fixed upon Jesus Christ the Lord. Who gives the ibis wisdom, or gives the rooster understanding? Oh, I like that one. That's funny. God gives a rooster understanding. Well, you see a rooster. I grew up on a farm, so I've seen roosters. They'll chase you. They know how to defeat you. They know exactly when to go peck the backs of the hens so they can lay eggs. If a cat or a fox comes in, a rooster will attack it to protect the hens. How does it know to do that? I've said that also. How does an eagle know to fly 1,200 miles south every winter and fly exactly back to the exact same location, the exact same nest it had last year? You say, well, it's an eagle. Okay. How does a butterfly know to fly from Mexico all the way up to Minnesota and Canada? Now, they track birds with, you know, with trackers on their legs. Another one. You have 10,000 sparrows. But that one little baby sparrow will not answer to anyone except the one single mama sparrow that it knows. How does it know that? There's 10,000 sparrows. There's 5,000 mama sparrows going back and forth. And this little baby sparrow that's only been on the earth like 3 weeks will not answer to anybody except that one particular little sparrow that hatched it. Well, the answer is God, the hand of God. These things are nothing here. When you learn, nothing is random. You know how they try to teach on the earth that everything is random? I'm here to tell you God is in control of everything and nothing is random ever. We like to say, oh, everything's random. Therefore, we can't do anything about it. That's not true. When you realize nothing is random, wow. Now, I know most people would disagree with me. I mean, what about a car wreck? I'm not saying that God wanted the car wreck. I'm saying God gave you free will. He's even in charge of what when you get in a car wreck by misusing your free will. When you realize nothing is random and that God has a specific plan for you, just like he takes a specific certain bolt of lightning and sends it down to South Dakota and then it comes and reports back to him. That's what we just read. So if you say, well, what about me? Does God have a specific path and a specific design and a specific plan for my life personally? And when you find out, yes, he does. Then you have to come to the conclusion, holy smokes. Why am I trying to create my own path? Why am I trying to make my own decisions? Why am I trying to come up with my own rules? Why am I trying to give myself my own pleasure? Why am I doing these things? Why am I not finding out what the path was that God has for me? Like we just read, John the Baptist was a man sent specifically by God. Sent specifically by God with a specific plan from God to do a specific task for God. And God has a specific plan for me, you, everybody, and 75% of the people on the earth will never believe in Jesus and find out what their plan is. And out of the 2 billion believers, the overwhelming majority of believers will go their own way and never find out what God's specific plan was for their life. Otherwise, you would see a whole different world down here. We're almost done here. Who has the wisdom to count the clouds? God can tell you how many clouds are on the earth right now. Who can tip over the water jars of the heavens? Wow. You know, angels can't do any of these things unless God tells them to do it. When the dust becomes hard and the clods of earth stick together. That's dirt clods. That's where we get the word clods of earth. Do you hunt the prey for the lioness and satisfy the hunger of the lions when they crouch in their dens or lie in wait in a thicket? God is saying, I feed the lions. I satisfy the hunger of the lions when they're crouched and roaring with hunger pains. Who feeds them? The hand of God. God gives them a zebra to stay behind so the lions can eat. Does God provide your food? Or does McDonald's, Burger King, and Hardee's provide your food? Think about it. What kind of food did God tell us to eat? Fruits, vegetables, rice, fish, some dairy, like olives, extra virgin olive oil, beans, mixed beans is a good one. Some old-fashioned cracked wheat bread. After that, everything in the store is complete junk and man-made and processed. After the things I just said, everything else is processed food. Unfortunately, even beef today, chicken, turkey, ham, it's all processed and it's all junk. It's not the same beef I grew up on. Now, that was real meat back then. Today, it's all fake. It's all just processed and manufactured for weight. Because it sells by the pound. Last verse. Who provides food for the raven? when it's young, cry out to God and wander about for lack of food. What we should have got out of there is God is in charge, my friend. Not me, not you. God is in charge. God has a specific plan for anyone who would follow his son, Jesus Christ. Anything outside of that is worldly stupidity. Now, I'm going to finish those last two or three chapters before I go back to the book of John. So you think you know who God is. You thought you knew who God was, but look at who God actually is. God is holy, independent, sovereign, in charge. He's always working. And this same God invited you to follow his son so you can be saved. Now, for God so loved the world, you see, he loves you. I guarantee whatever your life is today, it's about the complete opposite of what God really wants you to be doing. And that's about 95% of people in America have no idea what their godly path is. Because they've never asked God.